Well, if not, let's worship by standing up. And you can and sing our scattering song, When Morning Gilds the Skies. Hear the news, you are forgiven. We are set free to go out into the world and be loving, gracious, hopeful people of God. Amen. kids, do you want to come on up? That's stuck here.
Psalter with Psalm 139. And I believe that Val is going to help us with the response. And then I'll read the light print, and if you would read the dark print.
Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts.
O Lord, you have searched me and known me.
You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar.
You search out my path and my lying down, and are acquainted with all my ways.
Even before a word is on my tongue, O Lord, you know it altogether.
You pursue me behind and before, and lay your hand upon me.
Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high, but I cannot attain it.
Search me, O God, and know. Try me and know my thoughts.
Whither shall I go from your spirit?
Or whither shall I flee from your presence?
If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there.
But if I take the wings of the morning and settle in the outermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me.
If I say, let only darkness cover me, and the light about me be night.
Even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is bright as the day, for darkness is as light to you.
Search me, O God, and know my heart.
You knit me together in my mother's womb.
I praise you, for you are fearful and wonderful.
Wonderful are your works.
You know me very well.
My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately wrought on the depths of the earth.
Your eyes beheld me, unformed substance.
Your book were written in days that were formed for me, every day before they came into being.
How profound to me are your thoughts, O God! How vast is the sum of them!
If I could count them, they are more than the sand. When I awake, I am still with you.
Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts.
Oh, that you would slay the wicked, O God, and that the bloodthirsty would depart from me.
For those who maliciously defy you, who lift themselves up against you for evil.
Do I not hate them that hate you, O Lord, and do I not loathe them that rise up against you?
I hate them with perfect hatred. I count them my enemies.
Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts.
And see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way of everlasting.
Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know.
The Hebrew reading for today is from Ezekiel 11, verses 1 through 9. The Spirit filled me up and brought me to the east gate of the house of the Lord, which faces east. There, at the entrance of the gateway, were 25 men. Among them I saw Jaazaniah, son of Azur, and Pelatiah, son of Benaiah, officials of the people. He said to me, "Mortal, these are the men who devise iniquity and who give wicked counsel in this city. They say the time is not near to build houses. This city is the pot, and we are the meat. Therefore prophesy against them. Prophesy, O mortal." Then the Spirit of the Lord fell upon me, and he said to me, "Say, thus says the Lord, this is what you think, O house of Israel. I know the things that come to your mind. You have killed many in the city, and have filled its streets with the slain. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, the slain whom you have placed within it are the meat, and this city is the pot, but you shall be taken out of it. You have feared the swords, and I will bring this sword upon you, says the Lord God. I will take you out of it and give you over to the hands of the foreigners, and execute judgments upon you." Thus ends the reading.
Our New Testament reading this morning comes from the book of Luke, chapter 11, verses 37 through 44. While he was speaking, a Pharisee invited him to dine with him. So he went in and took his place at the table. The Pharisee was amazed to see that he did not first wash before dinner. Then the Lord said to him, "Now you Pharisees clean the outside of the cup of the dish, but inside you are full of greed and wickedness. You fools, did not the one who made the outside make the inside also? So give for alms those things that are within, and see everything will be clean for you. But woe to you Pharisees, for you tithe mint and rue and herbs of all kinds and neglect justice and the love of God. It is these you ought to have practiced without neglecting the others. Woe to you Pharisees, for you love to have the seat of honor in the synagogues and to be greeted with respect in the marketplaces. Woe to you, for you are like unmarked graves, and people walk over them without realizing it." So ends the reading of God's word. It was September 1993, and it was 103 degrees in Hell Creek, South Dakota, when dinosaur hunter Michael Hammer saw sticking up out of the ground the remains of a thesaurolophosaurus. I totally mashed that one up, sorry about it. But anyway, it was a plant-eating dinosaur, and it was a skeleton. It was almost complete. It was perfect. And Hammer says he knew right then and there that he had made a very special find. Scientists report that the inside of the dinosaur's chest, it seemed to be almost perfectly complete. And inside that chest, they found a heart of stone. The first dinosaur heart that had ever been seen by humans. That discovery took the scientific world by storm. And even though having a stone heart is usually not a good thing, they were so excited to have found that. Cher had a line in a song that said, "Don't you wish sometimes that you had a heart made of stone?" Well, I have to say though that having a heart made of stone is not exactly something that we should all be seeking. We see that in the book of Ezekiel, where the prophet was calling the exiled people of Israel back to the living God. He spoke of their hearts that they had turned to stone. The Bible teaches plainly that it really does matter what condition our hearts are in, and it really does matter what is inside of us. It goes beyond the things that we do. God is concerned about what we think and how we think. Before our lives can change, Christ has to penetrate through more than just our minds. Most people acknowledge the reality of God and the fact that Jesus is Lord. And yet it doesn't always move from head knowledge into our hearts. Jesus needs to penetrate the heart of those who make up his church. One of the main roles of the prophets that God raised up was for them to call the people back to God. They would call the people to repentance. They would call the people to return back from their idols and their false gods and turn back to the one true God. In Psalms 139, David prayed, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Test me and know my anxious thoughts. See if there is any offensive way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting." David's prayer is essentially for God to reveal his faults and innermost inadequacies. He wanted God to reveal to him the faults of his heart in order to help him and to correct the problem. That would give David a starting place. Then there were the Pharisees. Jesus was really hard on the Pharisees. And the main reason was because of their hardened stone hearts. It puzzles me how people that possess so much knowledge about God and those that did so much in the name of God could have such hearts that are hardened, have such hearts of stone. And it's true, the Pharisees did have hearts of stone. Think of this. They could find joy in the disgrace of a woman who was caught in the act of adultery and take pride in the fulfillment of the disgrace of that woman in order to stone her to death. They could look at the situation of Jesus doing good and they could find fault in that. Their hearts were truly, it seems, made of stone. The hard-hearted are not always the easiest to identify, however. Let's look at what constitutes a heart of stone. One of the symptoms of a heart of stone is the loss of compassion. Do you ever find yourself making judgments on others? Maybe they actually made their beds and so they really do need to lie in it. Well, the truth is that is not how we have been called to view people. And that is not how Jesus views people. I need to stop and I need to reevaluate my thinking when I find that I'm leaning more toward people being judged harshly than I am for people to receive grace and mercy. That type of thinking is a symptom of a heart made of stone. Our hearts should break over the very things that break the heart of God, and we should be moved to action. As Christians, we are in the process of being changed and transformed into the image of God. Over time, however, many of us lose our desire to continue to grow in our faith and do God's will. It's when we stop growing and when we stop caring to grow that we can tell that our hearts have become calloused. Oftentimes it's our own conscious choices which creates opportunities for our own spiritual maturity. When we stop caring to create those opportunities, we know that our hearts are hardening. We just take a look. And that, my friends, is what is called apathy. Apathy is a lack of interest or concern. It's a lack of emotion. It's a lack of feeling. And people with stone hearts are apathetic. Spiritual growth isn't anything they're interested in pursuing. They're perfectly content where they are in life. People with stone hearts think that they're okay because of their past victories. Because of how spiritual they used to be or how faithful they once were. And yet they are not exactly tuned into what their heart condition is now. We need to look at our hearts. Are we apathetic? Are we apathetic toward learning God's word? Perhaps we find excuses to miss church. Perhaps our hearts are in jeopardy of turning to stone. Another way to recognize the stone heart is realizing that we have lost excitement in the work of God. Finding ways to serve God, to be used, to be the hands and the feet of Christ. No matter what our situation in life happens to be. Now that's a way of softening our hearts and slowly chiseling away at a stone heart. Creating a heart of stone happens over time, and one sure way to build a heart of stone is by sinning. The reality is that we are all sinners, of course, and we have all sinned, and we have all fallen short of the glory of God. But the scriptures makes it clear, and makes a clear separation between sinning and the continued practice of sin. Sin is just a part of life, and yet sin is wrong, and we need to strive to avoid sin. But it is the continued practice of sin, or a sinful lifestyle, that hardens our hearts. Perhaps it's something that doesn't feel like it's a big deal, that it's okay, it's just a little sin that maybe I had to tell a few white lies, because we all know that God's going to forgive us, right? But the reality is that sin creates a heart of stone. Another way to turn our hearts to stone is to stay away from church. Missing church will make one callous and hardened as well. This isn't about missing a stellar sermon. Trust me on that one, please. But rather, the scriptures teach us that as iron sharpens iron, one person sharpens another. The fellowship we experience with each other is crucial, and missing church and the communion we experience with each other hardens the heart. Okay, so how do we soften our hearts? It begins by chiseling away at the stone, by letting the Holy Spirit in. It was the Holy Spirit working on the hearts of the Jews on Pentecost when they said they were pierced to the heart. Studying the Word of God is the next step of one of the greatest remedies for a hardened heart. There's something special about gathering in fellowship as well that has a way of softening the heart. If your heart is hardened, one of the best things you can do is consciously make a choice to be where God's people are and to find opportunities of fellowship. I believe another way that our hearts are softened and chiseled away at is by being careful what we allow into our hearts in the first place. God taught plainly, as did Jesus, that it really does matter what we allow into our hearts, because what goes in our hearts will eventually come out again. Perhaps you need to guard your heart and to remove some things from your way so that you are not polluting your minds and your hearts. By guarding our hearts and keeping ourselves clear from impure thoughts and other things that might harden our hearts, we can chisel away at our hardened heart. And finally, it's essential to soften a hard heart through repentance of our sins. Repentance is not just being sorry for our sins that we've committed. It's a change in lifestyle, and it's a change for the better. And is it a change of lifestyle so that we are better able to live our lives for Jesus? Isn't that what we're all seeking? Let's make that so. Amen. stand as you're able for our song of response. Lord, I want to be able to.
Hear our prayer.
Other prayer requests that you'd like to lift up? Ms. Caroline.
For Grandma Karen coming home safely.
Yes, and Grandpa Blue.
For Grandma and Grandpa who have come home safely from their travels. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear
our
prayer.
Sam.
Prayers for my mother who is going to Montana.
Prayers for Savannah's mom who is going to Montana. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Karen.
Prayers for our great niece who's been in ICU for a week. She's a week old, and that she will be able to go home soon and have a normal life.
Prayers for great niece who has spent the first week of her life in the hospital and will be going home, and prayers that she's going to thrive and have a normal life. Lord, in your mercy. George.
Prayers for my brother who is experiencing extreme depression.
Prayers for George's brother who is going through severe depression now. Lord, in your mercy. Lois.
I have two, one for Sandy Magnuson, who is going to have a biopsy on Thursday, and she needs her prayers. Then for Leanna Sickies, who fell on her knees, she'll find out tomorrow the results. They think it's a fractured kneecap.
Oh, no. And Leanna just had a new knee put in not that long ago. So prayers for Sandy Magnuson and her biopsy. And prayers for Leanna, who fell on her knee. Oh, gosh. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our
prayers. Karen?
Prayers for my cousin, Jeff, who has a staph infection and had to have a valve replaced in his heart. He's in ICU.
Prayers for cousin Jeff. Ooh. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayers.
Jeff?
Just prayers for people whose internal demons overwhelming, and prayers that we will be able to see that and find ways to help.
Prayers for people who are struggling with internal demons, and prayers that we're able to reach out a hand and be able to help them. Lord, in your mercy. Louise, sorry.
Throughout the service and every day, I give thanks for my mom. Even though she's been gone for a period of time, the faith and the blessings that she has instilled in me. And today, thinking about Dorothy and thinking about her, I remember on the day that she passed, she was in the emergency room and she said, "Lord, keep my feet on your firm foundation." Mm-hmm. And I think of that many, many days because her feet were certainly there, and I hope that mine can stay there.
Amen. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
Are there others? Oh, yes.
Birthday wishes for my Aunt Audrey Coop, who's 96 today.
96 for Audrey Coop. Oh. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
If there are no more prayer requests, let's bow our heads. God of all graces, we come to you just as we are, full of hope, but also doubt. Seeking your promise of new life, but struggling with our past, comforted by your word, but also heavy with burdens. We try to see the world as you see it, full of responsibility, the possibility of redemption. We try to see its systems threatened with resurrection, but the possibility of life, even when it's hard, not to focus on the destructive nature of humans. Our world seems to us at times chaotic, without reason, random, full of violence and needless suffering. We see images of the places that are war-torn. We see images of bitter divisions among our elected leaders. We see images of gun violence throughout our country. We see images of children who are hungry. And we see those who have no homes and seem hopeless. We see these images and it's difficult for us to imagine the world as you see it. It's difficult to imagine that a new world is possible. It's difficult to imagine the possibility of transformation. Yet we trust in you, O God, of all possibilities. We believe, help our unbelief. Transform us into partners in the world's transformation. As we ourselves are transformed into agents of your justice, mercy, and love. And hear us now as we pray the prayer your Son taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
And now, may Christ dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Our ascending song this morning is Jesus Calls Us. Please stand.